Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Catholic Culture Podcast. I'm pretty excited for today's guest because I've been enjoying his writing for the past several years. You probably are familiar with him yourselves. His name is Edward Feser, and he is a Catholic philosopher. He teaches at City College Pasadena and is well-known for a number of his books, probably preeminently The Last Superstition, which was his blistering critique of the new atheism. Also, more recently, for Five Proofs of the Existence of God and for a book, By Man Shall His Blood Be Shed, which is a book about the Catholic teaching on the death penalty, which stirred up quite a bit of controversy in recent years. Today, he's here to discuss his new book from Ignatius Press, All One in Christ, A Catholic Critique of Racism and Critical Race Theory. Ed, thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me. Great to be on.
Like I mentioned, I've been reading you for quite a long time now, but this is actually my first time reading one of your books. I've been reading your blog for several years. Mm-hmm. It's something that's been very helpful to me. I know that I've mentioned this to you, and I've mentioned on the show in the past, but I used to be a libertarian, and we both have a sort of a similar libertarian background. I was very into, you know, Ludwig von Mises and Murray Rothbard and stuff like that, you know, in my early 20s. And I went to the Mises University summer program that they have there in economics mm-hmm. and political philosophy down in Auburn, Alabama. You were a fellow of some kind at the Mises Institute at one point, right?
I wasn't a fellow, but I did attend some of their events, and I write sometimes for some of their publications, and I'd have scholarly interactions with people who were affiliated formally with the Institute. Yeah, it's been quite a while. That was up until the early 2000s, sort of the late night. I think more like 2000 up to 2004, thereabouts, that window, 2005. Yeah.
Because I remember even when I stumbled across your writings on libertarianism, they were already somewhat old by the time that I found my way to them. But I had been reading your blog, and like I said, I mentioned this on the podcast before a long time ago, but I was a libertarian for a while. It was my introduction to, you know, Ron Paul was the first time I heard of there was such a thing as political philosophy, you know, despite growing up Catholic and going to a good school. It just wasn't something that was discussed. That side of the faith wasn't discussed that much. Yeah. And so just to find that there was somebody with consistent principles beyond just being a Democrat or a Republican was very exciting. And, you know, I found them appealing for various reasons. But after a couple of years of being a libertarian and sort of flirting with, Rothbardian anarcho-capitalism, again, this would have been, you know, like 2012, 2013, something like that. I realized after getting a little more familiar with Catholic social teaching that libertarianism, at least of the kind that I had been interested in, was not compatible with Catholic social teaching. So I just kind of accepted, okay, I'm not going to be a libertarian anymore. But I didn't really have the arguments. I didn't really know why it was wrong. I just sort of accepted it on faith. I guess that was a grace to be able to do that. But eventually I came across some old blog posts you had written mm-hmm. on the topic, and they were very helpful to me. And in particular, you had written a journal article on a critique of the libertarian theory of property rights. And I, in a past episode of this podcast, I'll link to it in the show notes, I discussed this article at length, and it ended up being a pretty popular episode. I remember writing to you about it at the time, but that was such a great, helpful thing to encounter and sort of, you know, understand why there were sort of holes in, you know, Rothbard's reasoning about sort of property rights as the absolute principle but behind all of political philosophy.
Yeah. Yeah. Now that you mention that, it's funny. Prompts in my mind the thought that I came back into the Catholic Church toward the end of 2001 after having been an atheist for about a decade. And after, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 years, I don't remember exactly how long it was, but of a period of gestation, as it were, as I was kind of slowly working myself back into the faith, but hadn't yet committed myself until late 2001. And in doing so, I was very highly influenced by Aristotelian Thomistic philosophy. That was one of the big influences on me. At the time, I was also a libertarian. And so in my very early Catholic days, I still thought that one could combine those And my libertarianism was, it was not of what you might call a social or cultural type. In other words, it wasn't that I thought that, the ideal life was one of, with the popular, at least the popular understanding of libertarianism would have it, of, indulging in legalized drugs and that kind of stuff. I was never really interested in that. For me, libertarianism was
Right.
always a theory about government, not a theory about private morality. And so
That's right.
a libertarian position on something like that issue would be that even if drug use is immoral, which I always thought it was, even at the time, nevertheless, the government ought not to have any role in forbidding it or preventing it, and that it would be positively unjust, a violation of individual rights for it to do so. So that I used
Right.
to hold to that a kind of libertarianism. But as time went on in my early years in the Catholic Church, and I started to think through more consistently the logical implications of taking an Aristotelian Thomistic natural law approach to ethics, and specifically the foundation that natural rights have, if you're looking at these issues from an Aristotelian Thomistic point of view, it just gradually became clear to me that there was no way I could reconcile a libertarian theory of natural rights with a Aristotelian Thomistic theory of natural rights. And moreover, it was clear to me that there were certain teachings of the church, such as, for example, the teachings of the popes from Pope Leo XIII onward on the idea of a just wage and just prices and so forth, that you really couldn't reconcile with a doctrinaire libertarian position. When I say a doctrinaire libertarian position, by the way, just a little side note here, I don't mean that there's anything wrong with somebody giving arguments of an economic sort that market solutions are better than government solutions to this or that particular problem.
Right,
I'd say, okay, fine,
right.
let's hear those arguments out. They're either good arguments or not, and there's nothing wrong with considering those sorts of market solutions to different problems. I have no problem with that, and I'm very favorable to a lot of those sorts of arguments. But what I mean by doctrinaire libertarianism is the view that you see in people like Murray Rothbard and Ayn Rand and Robert Nozick, at least the earlier Robert Nozick, that it would be strictly contrary to justice, because strictly contrary to natural rights, say, for government to say interfere with a market contract to work for a certain wage. That if the government, say, were to say that you had to pay X amount to your employees per hour, that that would not only be, say, economically dubious, but it would be positively contrary to justice, that the employer has a natural right to charge whatever he wants, and the employee has a natural right to accept, even if it's a bad deal, whatever wage is offered. That's the sort of idea that I came to see. Now, you really can't reconcile that. You really can't reconcile the libertarian position with Catholic social teaching on things like just wages. Now, of course, that leaves open, well, what would a just wage be, and how do you determine that? And that turns out to be pretty complicated, and some Catholics are way too glib on that question. But what I came to see is that this doctrinaire position that it would be positively unjust and positively contrary to natural rights for the state to have any say in that, I came to see you just can't reconcile that with either natural law theory or Catholic social teaching. And so that was one of, wasn't the only consideration, but it was one of several considerations that led to me eventually abandoning libertarianism. And so sometimes when I have, people these days tell me because they don't like what I've written on capital punishment or something, they say, well, you're not willing to submit your intellectual will to what the church teaches. I think, what are you talking about? I mean, there have been other times where I've altered my position precisely because I could see that it wasn't reconcilable with what the church's teaching required of the faithful. And I don't dissent from anything binding on the issue of capital punishment or any other issue for that matter. But in any event, your comments on this earlier history of my thinking in political philosophy jog this sort of train of thought. I hope you don't regret it. But
No, sure, yeah.
It's a set of issues I haven't thought about for a while, since it's been quite a long time since I was a libertarian or even really attracted to that sort of approach in political philosophy.
Yeah, I mean, I was never able to, even at the height of my libertarianism, I never quite take that step and agree with Rothbard that all rights were property rights. That just seemed way too monomaniacal to me, you know, even at the time. Even though I couldn't come up with a positive argument for authority other than, you know, church authority explicitly, you know, God ordained church authority. I just had a very anti-authoritarian disposition from early childhood, you know, that made it appealing to me. And also just the simplicity of it did appeal to me on some level, the philosophical purity of it, to where it almost erodes all prudential questions away. And so you can just have everything laid out clearly in the abstract. That was very appealing to me. And that's how ideology tends to be. I think that's part of the appeal of ideology. But then once I got rid of that, once I let go of that, I kind of realized, it wasn't just that I was letting go of libertarian. It was like, okay, ideology in general is not going to work for me because that's just not how these things work. You know?
No, that's absolutely right. And there is, especially in this kind of hardcore doctrinaire libertarianism that I'm describing, with Rothbard, Ayn Rand, Robert Nozick, things like that, part of the intellectual and emotional appeal of it is precisely that it gives you a very simple, crisp, clear system and a very easy to use criterion for determining, okay, what's going to be my position on issue A, B, or C, or what have you. But political ideologies in general are like that, whether we're talking about Marxism or even really egalitarian liberalism of the John Rawls sort. They tend to really flatten out and simplify social reality. And as a result, you find, you know, I mean, in my earlier days as a Catholic, when I would get into arguments with people about libertarianism, there was this reflexive tendency, and I understood it having been a libertarian, but there was this reflexive tendency to think, okay, well, if you're rejecting, you know, the Rothbard or Nozick line on natural rights and on property rights in particular and taxation and so forth, well, that means you're just really opening the door to any degree of state intervention that you that you like. And it's just a ridiculous conclusion. Of course, that doesn't follow at all.
That's what Rothbard does. Rothbard always says, like, okay, his big thing is showing that any specific line must be arbitrary, and therefore you can't really say anything for certain. Like, if he can take down a particular solution that you give as arbitrary, you know, as not sort of strictly necessitated by economic or philosophical laws, you know, then the whole thing must be just completely, you know, open to any extreme position, you know?
Yeah, there is that tenet. And I would just say, well, I mean, you look at it, this all depends on what your theory of natural rights is. What is it that grounds natural rights? And, you know, thinkers like Rothbard tend to say, well, it's ultimately self-ownership, but the idea of self-ownership actually presupposes rights rather than really being a ground of rights. But I would say, well, this is no surprise to you or any of your listeners who know my work, but the correct approach to grounding natural rights, including property rights, is an Aristotelian Thomistic natural law account where rights have a teleological function. They exist in order to safeguard our capacity to perfect ourselves by pursuing the ends that natural law sets for us. Now, that gives very definite boundaries to what others can do to us, including the state. But the boundaries aren't quite as restrictive as a natural rights libertarian like a Rothbard or a Nozick or an Ayn Rand supposes. But again, they're operating with this very simplistic model where it's either, you know, it's either their position or it is socialism, you know, and it's a false dichotomy,
which is what Mises said.
Right. Yeah. Yes. You know, I think he has an essay, the middle of the road policy leads to dictatorship or something.
That's right. Well,
okay. I mean, it doesn't, you know, and let me explain to you why, you know, and you can set out the principles that would prevent that from happening, but.
Now there's something else I appreciate about your blog over the years, and that is your taste in music. because I have a background. I have a background, you know, as a jazz pianist. My degree is actually in jazz piano. I've been on and off professional over the years, and so you know, in the conservative Catholic sphere, even people who are into good music, they tend to immediately go to classical music and sort of ignore the American, you know, yeah. the American heritage, you know?
Yeah.
And so to have you be into, you know, Thelonious Monk and Steely Dan and things like that was always very, very affirming to see that. Not to mention your, you know, to get off of music, you know, doing an analysis of, you know, Glengarry Glen Ross and things like that, I always really appreciated.
Well, I try to keep things lively. I thank you for noticing and for expressing your appreciation of that.
Do you find that, I mean, do you find that there's sort of in the conservative Catholic intellectual world, that there's more jazz fans than you might think?
Oh, sure. I think so. Yeah. And, you know, probably part of the reason that it's not more noticeable is just that, you know, I have a kind of advantage in being a philosopher and writing a philosophy oriented blog, which is that philosophers have a tendency to philosophize about everything, you know. There's the old joke. I mean, it's, I don't know how old it is or how much of a joke it is outside philosophy, but anything you can do, I can do meta, right? So if you're a philosopher, if somebody else is doing physics, well, I can do metaphysics. You know, if they're doing ethics, I can do meta ethics. I can, in other words, instead of talking about the subject matter, I can talk about the subject matter as opposed to within the subject matter. I can philosophize about it. So naturally, there's a temptation, I think, for any philosopher, and that would include Catholic philosophers and Thomists, to, consider a work of popular culture or anything for that matter, and start asking about what philosophical lessons might be conveyed in it, or what philosophical assumptions might lurk behind it, or how might it be used to illustrate some philosophical point. And so it's very often that I might just be watching a movie or reading a comic or listening to a piece of music or something, a Steely Dan tune or something, and some philosophical thought occurs to me. And before you know it, I've got a nice little blog post, you know, and boom, there you go. And so I think just the fact that, as a professional philosopher, I tend to look at things from that point of view, it opens up the door to all kinds of subject matter that might at first glance seem odd to see on the blog of a Catholic philosopher or a Thomist.
Well, it's particularly interesting to see you recommending Thelonious Monk because, you know, there's jazz musicians you could pick who are maybe a little bit more might appeal more to people who like their music to be very, you know, sort of Bach-like, you know, if you wanted to listen to some Bud Powell or Lenny Tristano or whatever, you know, it might be a little bit more sort of like, oh, this is very intellectual. Not that Monk's music isn't. I'm not saying that at all. But Monk's music does have a little bit more of a mystery, a little bit more of a quirkiness to it.
Yeah.
A real simplicity to what he plays. Let me ask, what's your case to my audience for checking out Thelonious Monk?
Oh my goodness. Well, I haven't thought about this for a while. You're probably aware I wrote a blog post or two about that several years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And anybody, who wants to check it out can take a look at my blog and just, you know, go to the search bar and type in Thelonious Monk. And that blog post will come up. And to give you the full case, I suppose I'd have to go back and reread what I wrote there. And it's been a little while since I thought about it. But I mean, in the case of Monk, I think there is actually a kind of structure to his music and to bebop in general, but it's not a straightforward, mm-hmm. simple one. It's kind of like reality in that way. You know, I mean, you look at the created order and God, you know, as they say, writes straight and crooked lines, right? And that's how Thelonious Monk plays. So I think when people, and I remember I wrote that post, and gee, that could have been like 8, 9, 10 years ago now. But you got a few people who sort of showed up in the comments section and they were a bit annoyed that I would be defending that style of music.
But did they say disordered? Did they use the word disordered?
Yeah, somebody probably threw that out there. That's like
a favorite word of conservative music critics.
Yeah, exactly. And I would say, well, I think you have I would say to somebody who says that I think they have a too simplistic a conception of order. There's very definitely an order mm-hmm. there, but it takes a little nuance to see it. Now, of course, I'm not ruling out that I'm not saying anybody who dislikes it that somehow they're philosophically shallow or something. I'm not saying that. I mean, obviously there's an element of personal taste to this, but I think you get some people who wrongly suppose because they have a very simplistic model of order or of other aesthetic values that forms like jazz in general, or bop in particular, or different styles of rock, that somehow they violate the norms of a sound aesthetics, particularly a classical Platonic Aristotelian Thomistic aesthetics. I just don't think that's true at all, and I think it reflects a very simple conception of order in the case of Monk's work. I don't think it's disordered. I think it's complex. That's different. I think I had a post way back when contrasting Monk with Ornette Coleman, where you could make that case more strongly. I mean, you listen. I don't know if you're familiar with Coleman's work, but you listen to his work, and you think it's kind of hard not to laugh. Or is this a joke? Now, even in his work, there is a kind of structure, but it's extremely abstract, and in my opinion, it's crossed over the point where aesthetic appreciation is really possible, and it's become a kind of a work of pure abstract theory, the way a lot of modern architecture is, the way a lot of other modern art is. And it's lost it really its ability to speak to anything but the narrowest of abstract intellectual interests in us. And so I'm not going to, I wouldn't necessarily go so far as to say, well, it isn't genuine art, it's phony, because I think he's trying to do something too. But it's I'm much more sympathetic in a case like that with the Philistine who says, oh, that's just noise, but I think some people are a little too quick to play that card because they have too simplistic a conception of order and too simplistic an aesthetic theory.
So would the idea be something like, in nature there is order, but it's not completely symmetrical. Like it has symmetry, but it's sort of a general symmetry. It's not like every detail is rigidly symmetrical, and there's sort of a spontaneity within order. It's not all the sort of idealized order of the way that in a cathedral, the plant forms in a cathedral are more sort of geometrically perfect than in nature, but the natural forms are also beautiful.
Well, that's true. That's absolutely part of it. And also, if you're in a cathedral and you're let's suppose you're first introduced to it, and before you see anything of it, you somebody just stick, they put a shroud over your face so you can't see anything, and then they take it off and you're face to face with a gargoyle or something, right? You might say, what is this? This is some kind of bizarre surrealist artwork. What kind of, don't tell me Christianity is beautiful. Well, you have to see it in a larger whole, right? This is a very Augustinian point, that what seems arbitrary and what seems unintelligible is so only when looked at in isolation, but it's part of a larger puzzle. And this, I mean, in a way, the point is so straightforward, it's kind of a cliche, but there are certain kinds of order that you see only against a larger background, and you don't see them when you're just focusing on the thing itself, the way you do when you're looking at a simple circle or triangle or line or something. Other figures have a beauty not in themselves, but as part of some larger whole. And that's true, in my opinion, of many of the segments of a Thelonious Monk composition, say. It might seem disjointed when considered in isolation, but not when you see it in a larger whole. There's also an element here where I think experience plays a role in refining the mind's ability to appreciate something. So if a kid or even a teenager, say, takes his first sip of gin or scotch, you don't think, what is this? How can you drink this? This is a tool cleaner. Why would you even be interested in this? And whereas someone with a more refined palate can see, the beauty in it and appreciate it, and maybe even appreciate precisely that it has a kind of sting in the taste. And I remember, I mean, I you know I mean, for a long time, I've drunk almost nothing but gin martinis. Okay, that's been kind of my thing for a long time. Occasionally, I'll go for a scotch or something. But I remember when I first, tried them, I thought, "What is I, this? Is awful. How can anybody enjoy this?" I don't know exactly how I got over the hump, but now it's like
It's like a sort of a
I almost
dissonance.
from it. Yeah, I almost don't understand if somebody could not enjoy it, And of course, I'm tasting now what I tasted then, but from a different perspective, say. And there are a lot of things in life that are like this, obviously.
Do you have a favorite Monk album?
No, I don't. I mean, I'm probably not enough of a connoisseur to say. So I don't, you know, there are monk compositions that for some reason, oh, it's slipping my mind. It's one of the most difficult things in his body of work. I don't know what the title
Brilliant
is.
Corners.
Yes, that's it. Thank you. You're reading my mind. Yes.
Yeah. That's the one album by him that I've listened to a lot. I'm not
Yeah.
the hugest monk expert either, but
Yeah.
yeah.
No, that's just wonderful. And the I don't know if you've heard the big band version of that particular tune,
I haven't, no.
but it's even better than the small group version of it, in my opinion. And part of the reason for that is part of the reason is that I've you know I mean when I first got into jazz, I got into it by way of big band music, and I don't really listen to that much these days. But when I was a teenager, I listened to a lot of it, and then I kind of segued into bebop and other things. But so then when I first heard Brilliant Corners, that the song at the album, in the big band version, it was like, first of all, it was like the best of both worlds. You know, you have this big brassy big band sound with a Thelonious Monk bebop composition. It's a very strange mixture. But also, that song is extremely difficult to play. And I don't know that from playing. I'm not a musician. I was tried to be a little bit when I was younger, and I was awful. But from what I've read about the composition of it, you know, Monk's players had great difficulty playing it. And sometimes they would, I think in the recordings that ended up on the albums, they might even have stitched together, kind of like Steely Dan
It's
often does.
spliced.
You know,
It's like mega.
spliced
There's
together.
they
Yeah.
spliced it a bajillion times.
Yeah, exactly. And then so then when you hear that in the big band version, and organizing that whole herd of a big band to play that thing, and at the speed that the last part of it has to be played at, it's with all that brass, you know, sort of roaring. I mean, it's a very impressive piece, in my opinion. So if you haven't, I think you could
Well,
find it on YouTube.
it's interesting how things get how the level gets raised in terms of technique in different areas. I mean, like if you look at acrobatics now versus acrobatics footage of Olympic acrobats in the 1920s, you know how much simpler what they were doing was. And you know, same with music, like you know, Coltrane's Giant Steps is a good example. Like everybody's expected to be able to play that now, you know. But when he first, it was this new thing when he put it out there, you know, and his band could he was struggling with it, you know.
There are a lot of things that
So
are like that. I mean, this is totally out of left field, so pardon me for the digression on the digression, but my kids love to go to Six Flags Magic Mountain out here in LA. And they go there, and you've got these coasters. You've got like Revolution and Colossus, which some people around the country probably heard of. When they came out in the mid 70s, when I was a kid, those were scary things to get on. You know, you wouldn't want to. You mean this one's got a loop and so forth? And now they're like the baby rides, you know. And so, I mean, you know, from amusement park rides to music, and really the arts in general. A lot of what might seem shocking and how could anybody do this? How could you go for this? How could you be into this and so forth? A lot of that just reflects what people are used to at a particular time in history, and what at one time is, you know, shocking and startling is, you know, is old hat. And of course, somebody might say, well, couldn't that reflect decadence, you know? Well, in some things it certainly does, but that's because we have independent reason to believe that certain things are intrinsically gravely immoral. And so obviously a lot of stuff that shows up in the movies these days, it's not just that, well, you know, we've evolved as a culture or something. No, we have just become more decadent. But that's because we're talking about things that is sexual sins and so forth, which we already know independently to be inherently immoral. But that doesn't mean that everything that involves a kind of transformation of tastes, from getting used to the taste of scotch to getting used to a certain style of music to getting used to, you know, a bigger roller coaster, that somehow amounts to a dulling of the moral sense or something.
Well, yeah, you know what? We should get together some other time and do an episode about music, because I like to have an excuse to talk about jazz on this podcast. It doesn't happen that often, but I feel like having someone like you on would bolster my case, you know, to my listeners. Yeah, well, we should probably transition into our actually, it doesn't make a bad transition into today's topic. You know, it's speaking about, you know, a great art form created by African Americans, you know, that maybe some conservatives could stand to get themselves familiar with, just as part of our sort of our country's wider, you know, musical heritage. Yeah, so you wrote this book, All One in Christ: A Catholic Critique of Racism and Critical Race Theory. Now, obviously, this was a book that needed to be written. I don't think I need to argue that to my audience, at least most of my audience.
I'll hold it up as you're mentioning it, just
What made you to? Oh yeah, thanks. What made you decide to? I'm going to be the guy to write this book.
It was precisely for the reason you said that it needed to be written. It's a topic that I have zero interest in from an intellectual point of view. So I've written on a lot of topics. I've written on philosophy of religion. I've written on philosophy of mind, political philosophy, ethics. I've written on aesthetics and music and all kind of comic books, you know, all kinds of stuff. And all of those things I'm interested in. Ibram X. Kendi and Robin DiAngelo, zero interest. And those, of course, are just the popularizers of these ideas that ultimately derive from critical
right.
race theory, which is, you know, is, as its defenders like to say, well, it's just a legal theory. Well, it did start out that way, though it didn't remain there. But the ideas, as given expression by those theorists too, I don't find of any real intrinsic intellectual interest. As a matter of fact, reading all this stuff in working on the book, I found depressing because of page after page after page of blatant logical fallacies of what I think as basically, you know, bitter, angry, resentful view of the world, a very ugly and paranoid view of the world. So it's not a subject that I find intellectually very interesting. I don't, it's, you know, responding to Kendi or DiAngelo or these people is really no more interesting than responding to Richard Dawkins or, you know, Jerry Coyne or someone like that when they're writing on new atheism. It's just, it's a task one has to do because, you know, people are buying these bad books and peddling this stuff. And so someone has to respond to it. And I, you know, it was much with the new atheism when I wrote The Last Superstition in the late 2000s, 2008 is when it came out. I did it because I, you know, I found these ideas those guys were peddling to be obnoxious and stupid and not worth the paper they're printed on and certainly not worth the attention they were getting. But nobody was really saying what to me seemed to be like the things that had to be said about them. So I thought, I'll do this book because I'm so annoyed about it, but not because Dawkins and Harris and Hitchens and all those guys were really writing anything intellectually substantive. And the same thing's true of critical race theory. When this stuff started, this is stuff that anybody who's in academia, you've heard this kind of stuff peddled for years. And but it's always kind of, at least in my field, it was always kind of off in the background in the fringe, and it was the sort of thing you could safely ignore. And then suddenly in mid to late 2020, everybody's talking like one of these robots, you know, spouting this jargon. And I thought, what the hell? What is this? You know, what's going on here? And there were people criticizing it. But to me, it seemed like people weren't saying everything that needed to be said about it. And were thrown on the defensive and taking it much more seriously than they had to. And in a lot of cases, out of intimidation. And so I thought, well, you know, this is something I think needs to be addressed. And so I'll write this book on it. But it's, you know, other than working on the book, I don't think much about it. I don't like thinking about it. I don't find it a pleasant topic. And it's one where, if anything, the abuse and obnoxiousness of people on the other side is worse than is the case with your kind of stereotypical central casting village atheist that you might come across on Reddit or Twitter or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, you know, I want to make clear, I'm not talking about every atheist. I'm talking about the village atheist, right? So there are, of course, atheists who are very serious people and serious scholars and well worth interacting with and engaging with, and I've done so. But then there are people who are just loudmouths, okay? And it could be very obnoxious,
right.
And that's the sort of new atheist phenomenon, you know? And if anything, with the critical race theory stuff and related issues, the inability to reason logically or to attribute good faith to anyone who disagrees is even worse. So that's all a very
well
long...
because it's built into the ideology,
yes,
in a way that it's
right.
not necessarily built into atheism.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah, it is. It's baked into it, and so that's all a long-winded way of saying that I wrote it because I thought, you know, somebody's got to say this, and I'll say it. But I don't, you know, it's not something I want to spend my life thinking about, or even, to be honest, 5 more minutes thinking about. You know, because there are other topics that are just much more intrinsically interesting. But the ideas are out there, and unfortunately, there are people who think it's pretty hot stuff, and so some response to it needs to be made.
Yeah. Well, the subtitle is A Catholic Critique of Racism and Critical Race Theory.
Yes.
So you situate your criticism of critical race theory within the church's teaching on race and against racism. Mm-hmm. And actually, the first few chapters of the book are just about that. That's the most. As you were indicating, that's actually the most pleasant part to read, because we're getting the wisdom of church teaching,
right?
You know, and before we dive into the murk of critical race theory, I particularly liked, I have to say, that I think chapter 3 is the chapter on the rights of the rights and duties of nations and immigrants, and you draw from a lot of magisterial teachings of the past century, but also you have some great quotes from Pope John Paul II. I think it's his last book, Pope John Paul II's book, Memory and Identity. It's just some great quotes on the nation.
That's right.
So I have the book. I haven't read it. I've been meaning to, but very helpful, and it's a really robust. The church actually has quite a bit to say on these issues, and there's even a great quote from John the 23rd. I forget what the encyclical was, but on he talks about, you know, the situation of minority communities in nations ethnic groups that are a minority in a particular nation, and how they should try to handle themselves in sort of keeping their own culture, but also in assimilating and sort of he speaks of them as having responsibilities, which is pretty interesting. I mean, the church's teaching is a lot on immigration is a lot less, wishy-washy than you might expect, based on the way people portray it. And I know that immigration is not the main topic of the book, but for me, it was the most enriching chapter of the book, I would say, is reading your sort of the way you lay out church teaching on nationhood and immigrants is very interesting.
Well, it's something that inevitably comes up in these discussions. And so I thought that this was one of those areas where the entirety of the church's tradition and teaching, and current teaching for that matter, this isn't just documents of the past, need to be made better known. Now, as you mentioned, the first couple chapters leading into that third chapter on the rights and duties of nations and immigrants are on the church's teaching against racism itself. And one reason this is important is that, you know, part of this general so-called anti-racist movement, and critical race theory is a part of that, involves this attitude that somehow the evil of racism is something we're only now, in recent decades, coming to an awareness of, and that Western civilization in general has been blind to that and has really been the main wellspring of racism and hostility to anyone other than white European Christians and so forth. And that is something that simply does not stand up to a moment's scrutiny for anybody who really wants to look dispassionately at the actual record, in particular of the teaching of the Catholic Church. People think that, well, the church somehow became sensitive to the evil of racism only with Vatican II or something. That is complete nonsense. As I show in the book, the church has been consistent on this subject literally for centuries, for 500 years or so. And as the church notes in a 1988 document, The Church and Racism, racism as a kind of ideology seems to have arisen in the early modern period in conjunction with the slave trade and so forth as an ideological justification of this evil practice. But both the evil practice of the slave trade and the ideology of racism that was used to rationalize it were condemned by the popes and by the church from the beginning, and quite consistently in encyclical after encyclical. And I quote all this stuff in the book to show this. This isn't something that the church somehow had to learn from the secular world, where the church should go hat in hand and beg forgiveness or something to liberal secular opinion. Quite the opposite. It's something that the church thundered on for centuries. Now, there were, of course, Catholics who ignored the church's teaching on that. And you see in the papal documents.
And it was very easy to do that in the New World, you know, so far away from the seat of church authority and the royal crown of Spain and things like that.
Right. But, and that's precisely something that, as I say, the popes themselves would complain about, that the teaching was not being followed, or it wasn't being followed consistently, or it wasn't being taken seriously enough. But you actually have in these early papal documents You have excommunication of those who would enslave Native Americans, say. This evolved gradually into, I believe, excommunication even those who dared to publicly dissent from this condemnation of the enslavement and of treating other human beings as if they were mere property or as if they were animals or something like that. So the church has quite consistently and for centuries condemned this sort of thing. One of the reasons people don't see this is that they say, well, didn't the church for a long time defend slavery? And so they conflate that with slavery in the sense that people usually think of it in the American experience, the American South prior to the Civil War, and then they conflate that in turn with racism. But they're failing to make some crucial distinctions here. In the history of slavery, a distinction is traditionally drawn between what's called chattel slavery, which is what we usually think of when we think of as slavery, where someone claims ownership over another human being as if that human being was a mere piece of property, like a piece of wood or a stone or something or an animal that you could use in any way you see fit. That's chattel slavery. And that's what we think of when we think of what happened in the American South prior to the Civil War and so forth. But that's to be distinguished from other forms of servitude, like indentured servitude, which is kind of an extension of, what someone might be bound to as a result of a labor contract. An indentured servant was someone, say, who owed someone for a prolonged period of time, maybe even upwards to a lifetime, service as an employee, say. So indentured servitude was something was a case where you would be someone else's servant because you owed money to them or something. And then a third kind would be penal servitude, where you were made a servant involuntarily because you're being punished for some crime you committed. Now, what the church did not condemn as intrinsically evil were those second two practices, indentured servitude and penal servitude, where penal servitude is just like an extension of the sort of punishment that still exists insofar as somebody might be a prisoner and on a chain gang and that sort of thing. The church also, however, increasingly came to see that there are serious moral problems with those practices, even if they're not intrinsically evil. The idea being that, for example, if it's not intrinsically wrong to put someone in jail because of a serious offense, then okay, I guess it's not intrinsically wrong for them to be a servant as a punishment of some offense. And so, okay, the church taught that that's not intrinsically evil. But it also came to teach that, nevertheless, it's a bad practice because it tends to degenerate into chattel slavery. But chattel slavery, the first kind, that was always condemned as intrinsically evil. So that's not some new or novel teaching. And even the other kinds of slavery, as I say, the other kinds of servitude, the church has said are so morally hazardous that they just shouldn't exist in practice. They have a tendency to degenerate into chattel slavery. So people ignore, and I should also add that servitude of those other kinds had nothing to do with race. It just had to do with whether someone was, say, guilty of a crime or was in debt to someone or something like that. It wasn't a racial thing. So people conflate these things and they lump it all under the term slavery and they think, oh, well, the church only started condemning this in, maybe the late 19th century or even Vatican II or something. And that's just, it's A, ignorance of history. And B, a failure to make important distinctions of a theological kind.
Now,
Now,
one of the
you
really
mentioned that,
interesting things,
yeah, go ahead, Thomas, sorry.
one of the really interesting things early in the book is that you point out that the church teaching against racism and the church teaching on the equal dignity of all men before God, it's not based on the fact that we lack si strong scientific evidence for racial superiority or inferiority. I mean, that may be the case, but that's not why the church says racism is wrong. It's actually something more fundamental as a spiritual principle. So what is that?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's a very crucial point. The church's condemnation of racism does not stand or fall with this or that argument in biology. And people seem to think that, well, if you're opposed to racism, then you have to sort of, worry about whether someone's going to give some kind of biological argument for the superiority or inferiority of this or that race. From the church's point of view, all that stuff's irrelevant because the condemnation of racism goes much deeper than anything that's grounded in biology. It's grounded in the nature of human beings, first of all, as rational creatures. We have rationality, and in traditional Catholic philosophy, in Thomistic philosophy, for example. And not just for Thomas, but for Catholic philosophers in general, our intellects, our rationality is an immaterial aspect of our nature. It transcends our material bodily capacities. And it's the highest power of the human soul that God has to specially create in each new human being. And so one pillar of the equality of all human beings before God as having equal rights, equal dignity, whatever race they are, is that we all have immaterial souls, rational souls, to use the Thomistic philosophical jargon. And that's something that we know through philosophical argumentation, as well as through the church's divinely revealed teaching. And so it's something that biological science cannot establish, but also cannot undermine. It's grounded in something deeper than anything that science can tell us. It's grounded in deeper philosophical and metaphysical truths about human nature. And it's also grounded, the church's condemnation of racism, not only in our human nature, but on the fact that all human beings are also called to grace, that we are, the door is open to all of us to the beatific vision and to redemption from sin and so forth. That's true in the teaching of St. Paul and the church more generally, of all human beings of whatever ethnicity, whatever race, what have you. And that, once again, is something that has nothing to do with this or that finding of science. And so it cannot be undermined by any finding of science. It goes deeper than that.
Right. And the same is true of, you know, what we're more likely to find is that not all cultures are equal. You know, we can pretty much say, like, science doesn't give us evidence that you know, there's significant differences between people of different, you know, ethnic, biologically, you know, racial, biological backgrounds. I mean, there might be certain things about you're more susceptible to being lactose intolerant or things, but things like that, but nothing really morally significant, you know?
Right. They have nothing to do and, with our basic rights and
right. Exactly. Yeah. But we will find that, you know, not all cultures are equal, and there are wide divergences between cultures, at least in this or that respect, and sometimes just sort of on the whole. And it's important that the church is also not saying that, you know, the position against racism stands or falls based on your evaluation of the merits of different cultures.
Right.
You know,
so
because the church outright says not all cultures are equal, right. Certainly not in every respect.
Right.
And so
right.
that cuts people off at the pass. And I see many, you know, Catholic anti-racists saying this, where if you criticize a particular culture, ethnic culture at all, you are that's immediate evidence that you're racist. You know, like if I were to criticize, you know, rap music as degenerate, that would be immediate evidence that I'm racist to many people. You know, but we just spent 15 minutes talking about how great Thelonious Monk is. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
The idea that all cultures are equal in every respect is somehow contrary to Catholicism is refuted very easily just by opening up Scripture. Say, right? I mean, you find throughout Scripture condemnations of ancient cultures as. As lost in degeneracy, as beholden to idolatry and in all kinds of other ways, as defective and as in need of redemption and so forth. And, you know, obviously you see this in the Old Testament where, you know, Scripture condemns the cultures surrounding ancient Israel and tells the Israelites to avoid the idolatry and immoral practices and so forth that are practiced in these other cultures. You find it in St. Paul's epistle to the Romans, where he condemns the pagan cultures of his day and so forth. So obviously, well, those were human cultures, and yet they're criticized by Scripture. They're not criticized on any sort of biological or racial or ethnic grounds. They're criticized on cultural grounds. They're criticized because they reflected false values and so forth. And then, you know, throughout the history of the church has also always consistently condemned the idea that, say, every religion is equally good and praiseworthy. And maybe the most famous recent example of that was the year 2000 doctrinal statement, Dominus Iesus, where Cardinal Ratzinger, writing for Pope John Paul II, under the authority of Pope John Paul II, reaffirms the church's traditional teaching that it's only through Christ and through the church that human beings are saved and so forth, and so that other, I think the language it's used is that other Christian bodies are in a gravely deficient situation, lacking certain important truths, and so on and so forth. Well, that obviously implies that from a theological point of view, not every culture or not every worldview is equally good and so forth. And it's interesting that the people who make this claim, they say, well, if you say that every culture is equally, if you say not every culture is equally good, that somehow that's racist. At least of this very same people who out of the other side of their mouth say that there's this thing called whiteness, and whiteness is some property that all white people are somehow born into. And if you believe, say, Robin DiAngelo, it's inherently racist. It's inherently hostile to blacks and people of color. And it represents an oppressive point of view that whites have imbibed without even realizing it. And it manifests itself in microaggressions and implicit bias and all these sort of magical, invisible ways of being racist, allegedly, and so forth. But wait a sec, now you're denigrating an entire culture. And yet you just said that we have to treat all cultures as somehow equally good. And if we don't, it's racist. It's one of many incoherences in this so-called anti-racist position that's represented by critical race theory,
right,
and its popularizers like DiAngelo and Kendi.
And if it's not obvious that such a claim is utterly contrary to, you know, Catholic teaching and Christian charity, you know, if that's not already obvious, sure, the church hasn't taught explicitly on critical race theory. The church has explicitly taught against racism, so that would be condemned right there. But the church has also taught against other ideologies that critical race theory draws from, such as Marxism,
right,
and elements of postmodernism. Now, we're not making a simplistic claim here that critical race theory just is Marxism or whatever. Obviously, there's more nuance to it on an academic level than that. But one connection you could draw there is that idea of class consciousness, which in Marxism, which sort of denies the universality of reason and says that everybody is only able to think according to the advantages of their group.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
And so, you know, if you're part of the capitalist class or whatever, then you, any argument that you make on your behalf is suspect. And then if you're part of the, if you're part of the worker class, then if you make an argument that is not Marxist, then that means you have false consciousness. So then in, you know, critical race theory, you do have claims like, oh, so-and-so is not politically black. You know,
right,
I've heard that phrase used,
right,
for
right,
instance. So they have ways of getting around it. It's the ideology at all cost. You know,
right,
whatever goes against the ideology has to be dismissed one way or another, whether
right,
it comes from a white person, a black person, an Asian person, whatever. They just come up with tricks, basically,
yeah, so,
to
right,
dismiss
so,
these things.
You know, you have, you know, this idea that is associated with Marxism, that society is made up of classes that are of their very nature inherently hostile to one another, exploiting capitalists and exploited proletarians, say, and where, as you just summed it up, the sorts of arguments and opinions and so forth that would prevail in either of those classes just reflect the point of view of that class and cannot be evaluated apart from that point of view and have no objective validity and so forth. Critical race theory, especially as popularized by people like Kendi and DiAngelo, essentially just takes that model and replaces class with race. And it posits that there are inherently opposed racial interests. There's whiteness and white supremacy and white privilege and all that. And that sort of plays the role of the evil oppressing capitalist class in Marxism. And then there are the oppressed non-white races, people of color and so forth. And so they play the role. They sort of stand in for the proletariat in Marxist theory. But once again, you have this idea that they are inherently hostile to one another. Now, the church has consistently condemned that idea that any society is made up of inherently hostile classes. It condemns this in the case of Marxism, and by implication condemns it in the case of, well, it's not just by implication, in the case where we're talking about race as well. I mean, it's the idea that somehow races are inherently hostile to one another, the church has condemned as well in, for example, the document, The Church and Racism, which I cited earlier in our conversation here in 1988, and I quote a lot
right,
of that in the book. But that's one area where, you know, this idea, so for the church's perspective, every society is going to be made up of different people and different groups of people, and they all have their distinctive talents, their distinctive strengths. And the church has an organic model of society where the members of society are like the members of the body, all of whom work together for the common good. And so the relationship between classes and groups within society is one inherently of partnership. It doesn't always work out like that in practice, of course, just like in, you know, partnerships of the ordinary sort, whether it's marriage or a business partnership, things don't always go well. But nevertheless, that's inherent to the nature of the structure of the social order that we're describing here. That's how things ought to go, what we ought to work for. And that's as true in society as a whole as it is in the case of marriage or in the case of a business partnership. So the church rejects this idea that any groups of human beings are somehow inherently or in the very nature of the case at odds with one another or hostile to one another. And that can hardly be less true in the case of race than it is in the case of class. The church has also explicitly condemned this idea that philosophical systems, moral codes, worldviews in general somehow only reflect the perspectives of those who adhere to them and cannot be evaluated in any sort of objective way. That idea, which is essentially just a variation on relativism, which the church has clearly and consistently condemned, really makes of all disagreement ultimately a clash of wills rather than an engagement of minds who are pursuing a common truth. And it transforms every disagreement ultimately into a political power struggle. And you find some of these writers, like Kendi, are quite frank about this. I mean, Kendi comes out, he just says in his book, How to Be an Anti-Racist, that the movement he represents is not about changing minds and hearts. He thinks that's a waste of time. It's about power. He says that. He says he wants a movement whose adherents are driven by nothing more than the craving, he even uses the word craving, for power, for political power, and simply imposing the critical race theory program onto society, whether or not people agree with it or not. He's not interested in changing minds. He's interested in imposing his will. And that's inevitable if you take this view about human rationality, that it's really just a smokescreen for vested interests and a smokescreen for racist or, you know, in the case of Marxism, oppressive, economic interests or what have you. You're inevitably led to this, seeing human society as a power struggle, a clash of wills. And again, if the church condemns this in the case of Marxism, she can hardly condemn it any less where what's at issue is the relation between races rather than between classes.
Right. Now, let's talk a little bit about the way that Christians and Catholics can get sucked into this ideology. One, I think, way in which Catholic teaching has been corrupted or Christian teaching has been subverted with regard to social realities, going back to the Protestant revolt against the divinely ordained hierarchical structure of the church, is egalitarianism. I guess it's worth asking, we already talked about the equality of all men before God in terms of being made in God's image, being rational creatures, equally capable of union with God through the life of grace. What does the church say about other forms of equality and inequality?
Well, the church has also consistently taught that we need to draw a distinction between concern for the poor on the one hand, which every Christian has a duty to have, and to work for the improvement of the least well-off and so forth. But to distinguish that from the idea of equality in the sense of all material conditions being at the same level. And that is something that the popes have consistently taught is not possible consistent with human nature, because actual material conditions always depend on a very wide variety of circumstances. Contingent historical circumstances, facts about geography, cultural circumstances, all of these things converge to yield different distributions of wealth and income at different times in history among different groups and so forth. And it's inevitable given human variation. And so you see in Pope Leo the 13th, and you see in Pope Pius the 10th, and Pope Pius the 11th, and Pope Pius the 12th, and so forth. You see this consistent condemnation of the socialist idea that there is something intrinsically unjust or intrinsically evil about any sort of material inequality whatsoever. Now, that doesn't mean that every inequality is fine and dandy and justifiable. I'm not saying that. But you get this very extreme and simple-minded view in the work of people like Kendi, that according to which any inequity whatsoever is ipso facto, automatically, by that very fact, evidence of racism. It constitutes a kind of racism. Now, even he doesn't really consistently apply that, right? So if you have, for example, in some field, if, say, you know, whites are overrepresented relative to Black Americans, say, the claim would be, ah, well, that's evidence of racism. But if Asian Americans are overrepresented compared to whites, say, that's never treated as evidence of racism, which, of course, it's not. Mm-hmm. It's not evidence of racism at all. But if it's not evidence of racism in that case, why is it evidence of racism in the other case, right? Or you also find, because people like Kendi and D'Angelo and other critical race theorists, they sort of fold in feminism and gay liberation and the sexual revolution in general and so forth into this larger so-called anti-racist project. They would say, well, if you see that, you know, men are overrepresented in a certain field relative to women, then that implies sexist discrimination, say, right? And yet we also find, say, that men are massively overrepresented in the prison system, say, right? Is that evidence right. that there's anti-male animus to lock men up in prisons? Well, that's ridiculous. Of course not, right?
Right.
But you'd have to say that if you're going to stick to this kind of simple-minded inequity criterion of racism, that anytime there's any
and
sort of
and it's important
inequity,
to point out that that's an a priori principle of this ideology.
Yes.
It's not that they've looked at it and looked at all the different factors and decided that it must be racism because it can't be anything else.
Right.
It is an a priori principle
right.
that it must be racism.
Right.
It is an explicitly made assumption in advance.
Right. It's made in advance. You will search the writings of someone like a Kendi or a D'Angelo in vain for an actual argument. It's just asserted and asserted again and asserted again and asserted again. And any criticism of it, no matter how gentle, polite, deferential, is dismissed as racist. So the only argument against, you know, the only argument in favor of the idea that inequity is somehow inherently racist is, if anyone disagrees, shut up, racist. You know, that's the so-called argument. It's just a kind of ad hominem attack on anyone who dares to dissent from it. But again, looking at things from the point of view of Catholic social doctrine, the church has consistently said that social justice does not entail absolute equality between every citizen of society, between every human being. That's that, you know, it condemns that that idea associated with socialism as contrary to the natural order, which means that the idea that inequity somehow is a mark of discrimination or some other kind of injustice, that, first of all, it just doesn't follow. I mean, there's no argument for that. But second of all, it's something that the church has not only not taught, it's explicitly rejected consistently for centuries now.
Yeah. And there's plenty of social science evidence to the contrary as well. You talk about the works of Thomas Sowell in your book. I don't want to get into that. I just want to focus on the sort of the Catholic aspect of it here. But mm-hmm. I think just to keep it from just being a totally intellectual thing, it's important to point out that, you know, this is a very spiritually dangerous ideology to get involved with, even to a lesser degree in the Catholic world, because envy and resentment are spiritually deadly. I mean envy is a deadly sin.
Yeah.
So if you get into the mindset, even if not on your personal behalf, but on behalf of the group that you belong to, that any kind of difference, and we're not even talking about you know, dire poverty or things like that, but just, you know, how well are we represented in this field, or you know how often does my face show up on the big screen, or you know, that kind of thing, There can be a good way of working towards those things, you know, of encouraging, you know, if people of your ethnic group, you feel like there's untapped talent in mathematics, you know, among people of your ethnic group, then that's a fine thing to encourage. You also have to look at what are the cultural things in my ethnic group that are maybe holding those things back, right? As well as what are the external obstacles. You know, that's something that somebody like John McWhorter would talk about, where there's like certain ethnic groups have like almost an anti-intellectual or an anti-education popular bias, but the idea that you're going to look at others and blame them and resent them for being more represented in a certain profession or whatever the topic is, that's profoundly spiritually poisonous. So people should be warned about that as well.
Well, this brings me to a really important issue that has sort of come up in the last year or two since discussion of critical race theory and related ideas started to enter the news, which is that among the bits of disinformation that are thrown out by defenders of critical race theory is the idea that critical race theory is really just a matter of teaching the history of racism and informing people about it, mm-hmm. letting them become better informed about it.
Right.
And naturally, anybody hearing that thinks, well, yeah, how can you object to that? I mean, what's the problem with that? But that's a complete bait and switch. That's not what it's about. In fact, proponents of critical race theory, both the academic theorists who originated it and also the popularizers, people like Kendi and D'Angelo and so forth, they emphasize that the core insight, as they think of it, of critical race theory has nothing to do with what most people think of as racism. When most people hear racism, they think of things like the Ku Klux Klan. They think of slavery in the old American South. They think of Jim Crow laws, segregation. They think of the system in South Africa that was overthrown, I guess 20 years ago now, whenever it was. They think, okay, that's racism, and everybody agrees that that's bad. And so if we're teaching about that kind of thing, then people should know about that. But these writers are explicit. That's not what we're talking about. They hold that even if you get rid of all that stuff, the situation of non-whites would really remain essentially unchanged. They say that because the kind of racism they claim to identify is much more subtle. In fact, it's so subtle that you have to be a critical race theorist to identify it. You have to be an adept in the literature. And this is where you get concepts like microaggressions and implicit bias and all this kind of stuff. And this idea that even so-called progressives and liberals are really deep down as racist as everybody else. This is what the average person on the street doesn't understand when they hear this nonsense that, well, it's just about teaching the history of racism. No, it's a much more radical sort of vision than that. So, according to these writers, the way that the racism they're criticizing manifests itself is in biases that people who exhibit them don't even know they have. And they have in mind people like, say, you could think of the white progressive voter who thinks of himself as liberal and progressive, hates Donald Trump and, would never vote Republican, his life depended on, and so forth. But such a person, nevertheless, is racist without knowing it because, according to the theory, they have unnoticed biases, implicit biases, that's the jargon. And they routinely manifest microaggressions, which are aggressive in the sense of condescending or critical or in some other way hostile attitudes or actions toward people of color that they're not even aware that they are manifesting. So that every time, say, a white person is not sufficiently pleasant at work, say, to a non-white person, or doesn't smile when they pass a jogger who's not white or something, this counts as a, quote, microaggression. And if the person says, what, no, I was just having a bad day, or I didn't even see the person, I wasn't even thinking about it. Well, that's what you think, but it's really sort of white privilege and white condescension coming out. It's this kind of extremely paranoid worldview where racism is read into absolutely everything so-called anti-racist education is really about. And I think a lot of people who think, well, yeah, if you're just teaching about racism, how can anybody object to that? They don't realize that that's not the problem. That's not what is being criticized or objected to. What's objected to is this extreme theory that posits racism everywhere, including places you wouldn't expect it. Let me give you another example, even more important example. People typically think of the fight against racism in the United States in the history of our country for the last 40, 50 years or so, in terms of the civil rights movement of the 1960s, in terms of figures like Martin Luther King Jr., in terms of things like anti-discrimination laws, and treating everyone the same, whatever race they are and so forth. But critical race theory also explicitly rejects all that. And it says that anti-discrimination laws actually benefit whites. And the idea of colorblindness, Kendi in his book calls that, you know, the most dangerous sort of racism, that it really upholds white supremacy rather than allowing us to overthrow it. Mm-hmm. What we really need is a regime of discrimination against whites and in favor of non-whites in order to redress the so-called racist inequities that Kendi claims to identify. The whole idea of individual rights, of free speech, and of rationalism, of a sort of common human rationality that we can all appeal to in order to settle our disputes, all of that is rejected as somehow inherently racist and just as a smokescreen for the racist oppressor. Now, I submit that most people, even most, you know, Democratic voters and people who think of themselves as liberal and progressive, if they knew that that's what's being peddled under this label of anti-racism and critical race theory, they'd say, whoa, wait a sec. I don't want my kids being taught that. I don't think those are good ideas. So anyway, that's a bit of disinformation that that proponents of these ideas have been coming to hide behind over the last year or two, since these ideas started to get very wide circulation and to be widely discussed.
Right. Yeah. I mean, just to bring it back to the spiritual level, I mean, with something like microaggressions, it's like even when, if such things do exist to some extent, you know, or in life, I mean, we could all say there are little inconsiderate, you know, inconsiderate behavior of people, or just little weird vibes that people give us, not necessarily in a racial way, but you know, those things happen. But I mean, if you're looking for things to accuse people of, you're looking for grievances, you're looking for things to complain about. Again, there's this aspect of self-pity. There's this aspect of resentment, like you said, a paranoid orientation towards other people. There's an aspect of just of self-importance to it that, you know, it's like if you're looking at what we're supposed to be like as Christians, is this, you know, decreasing that Christ may increase in us? You know, is this really following the example of Christ to be constantly concerned about every possible little, you know, micro infringement on our, you know, our ego or, you know, whatever? I mean,
it's like we're replacing.
We're all supposed to be embracing humiliation. If there is something, you know, real or imagined, we're all supposed to be embracing, you know, look, if it's a consistent thing, you can tell someone about it. Hey, I don't like this little thing you do, or, you know, things like that. But we're supposed to be embracing, you know, death to self. We're supposed to be embracing humiliation, like, and that's all of us. And it doesn't matter whether you can come up with an ideology to justify justify the fact that you are not willing to just sort of like take the little buffets of life. You know what I mean?
Well, it's like, you know, when Christ says, when someone slaps your cheek, turn the other cheek, right? We're replacing that with, well, he didn't slap your cheek, but you should suspect that he probably wanted to, you know, and he was thinking about it. You know? I mean, it's exactly the opposite attitude.
Right.
It's this attitude of being suspicious of everybody of a certain race, and of reading hostile intent, and reading this sort of paranoid worldview into phenomena that are either entirely innocent. Or if they can be criticized, they can be criticized without having to appeal to these exotic ideas of implicit bias and microaggressions, all this kind of thing. As I note in the book, some have pointed out that the literature of critical race theory really teaches people to take on board attitudes very similar to those that in cognitive behavioral therapy are recommended against, because they tend to generate anxiety and depression. So if you go around, for example, reading people's minds and thinking that they have it out for you, and where a social engagement, a social interaction was uncomfortable, that it must have been because they're hostile to you, they mean you harm, and so forth. What's sometimes called catastrophizing, right? Where you always assume that the worst is likely to happen, and that those who disagree with you intend the worst for you, and so forth. And there are a number of these mindsets that you can get yourself into. Focusing only on the negative and not letting yourself focus on evidence against some negative interpretation of things. These are mental habits that in cognitive behavioral therapy are often identified as among the chief sources of anxiety disorders and of depression disorders.
Right.
And yet they're exactly the sorts of things that wokeness in general and critical race theory in particular tend to imbibe in their readers. It teaches people to be paranoid and to go around thinking yeah. that, you know, a whole group of people has it out for you and all of society is hostile to you. And even when they pretend they're not, that's a smokescreen. That's a lie. Don't believe what you see. And so, and this is a totally paranoid worldview, which is, of course, people are going to be angry and hostile to one another, and you're going to have increased social tension. And then one of the worst things about it is it tends to invite overreaction on the other side. So naturally, you're going to get jerks on the other side who fall precisely into racist attitudes. Because they think, well, if you're going to call me a racist anyway, I'm going to act like that, right? That's totally the wrong lesson to draw. But you end up stirring up so right. much hostility between people that it leads to this sort of polarization and mutual hatred. And then it just right. ratchets up. It's a kind of death spiral. And yeah, naturally, it's really then it's spiritually unhealthy. And it's exactly opposite to what Christ teaches us in the Sermon on the Mount.
Right. Yeah. There can be sort of a narcissism too. I've seen people refer to this as ethno narcissism or racial narcissism, where everything, even on issues that seem totally unrelated to race, you know, that you somehow manage to make it about that. This is about me. This is about my group. To take things that are about the whole church, you know, celebrating something good that happened. Oh, well, like a good example would be like, you know, the overturning of Roe v. Wade. You know, I saw, you know, self-proclaimed black Catholics on Twitter. It's not just a descriptor. Some people use it almost as though it's like a separate rite, you know, of the Catholic Church or something, who were complaining about it, like, oh, how is this going to affect, you know, racial, you know, just totally insignificant things next to this incredible victory of overturning, you know, the universal legality of abortion in America,
right.
you know, and making it about things. And I'm not even talking about like serious concerns, but just small little, just in the same way that a self-proclaimed Catholic feminist might say, well, you know, I actually saw an article I think it was in American magazine by a Catholic feminist saying, well, you know, I'm not happy about this Texas ban on abortions because, you know, until misogyny is eradicated, then, you know, we can't have this. We can't celebrate this victory. Right. And it's just this like this concern with self, this narcissism on behalf of yourself or your group. And it's a narcissism that gets passed because everybody's afraid to criticize it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you can clothe it in a social justice garb, but it's really just about yourself. It's really wanting attention.
Fanaticism in all its forms, ultimately, I think that, you know, the deep psychological, well, I don't want to oversimplify, but one of the psychological roots of it is a kind of narcissism, because the more fanatical and extreme your position, the more unlikely it's ever going to be realized. And that means there's more for you to criticize, right? We don't yet have utopia, whatever utopia is, you know, however you define utopia. Therefore, I can sit back and criticize society and feel good about myself and portray my and express my virtue by criticizing things. You know, one way I think about it is this, is that take an issue like abortion, right? Now, I'm as, you know, opposed as abortion to anybody, but I would be the last person to say that everything somehow is about abortion. That would be ridiculous. You know, if you're discussing some new movie, hey, what'd you think of the new Top Gun movie? What'd you think of the new Thor movie? You know, well, you know, I didn't say enough about abortion. You know, it's like, wait, what are you talking about? Not everything's about abortion, right? And if I say that, it's not because I don't take abortion seriously. It's just because, you know, to quote the line attributed to Freud, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. It's not a symbol. It's not an opportunity to pontificate about our socio-cultural ethical situation. It's just a cigar. Calm down, right? And sometimes a movie is just a movie, and sometimes a political event or a piece of legislation about abortion is just about abortion. It's not about race. It's not about sexism. Is just about abortion or whatever, right? So just like it would be absurd for a pro-lifer, someone who is against abortion, to bring abortion to every issue, and if he did so, it would be a kind of performance art, right? Someone who did that, you think, look, would you just shut up? You know, you're just trying to show us all how anti-abortion you are because you're bringing abortion to everything, right? The same thing's true with bringing race into everything.
Right.
It's because race is not really part of everything, but you make it sound like it is. You think you sound more virtuous because you see it everywhere. Other people don't, right? And some people are actually intimidated by this kind of idiocy, right? Oh, my God, I don't want to criticize this person, otherwise I'll be a racist, what have you. But it's just like if somebody said, speaking, you know, for myself as someone who's against abortion, if someone was bringing abortion to everything, you know, how did you like dinner the other night at the restaurant? Well, there wasn't anything on the table about abortion rights, anti-abortion. Come on, not everything's about that. In the same way, if someone tries to bring race into everything, they should simply be ignored and people shouldn't be intimidated by that because it's not everything is about that.
Yeah. And just for anybody listening who is seeing us, you know, two white guys, so to speak, discussing these issues and making strong statements about them, you know, and if you find that to immediately sort of disqualify us, I just want to suggest that that itself is an ideological criterion and you should just judge the claims on their own merits. You know, there's one more thing that I wanted to bring up before we go, Ed. One other way in which the faith gets subverted. And this is not just in the case of critical race theory, but in seemingly so many ideologies with regard to sort of social equality that some Catholics get drawn into, is this sort of replacement of salvation and liberation in union with God and God's love, with liberation in the sense of sort of empowerment. Mm-hmm. And that goes back to this topic of liberation theology, which is definitely seeing a comeback of interest because of racial issues in the United States. I mean, I'm seeing young Catholics get very into this.
Right. This is something I address in the last chapter of the book. And liberation theology is this movement which gained notoriety in the 1980s when Pope John Paul II was Pope and Cardinal Ratzinger, who later became Pope Benedict XVI, was head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. And so they had to engage in kind of a dispute with liberation theology throughout that period. Liberation theology is basically an approach that wants to assimilate Christian doctrine and Christian morality in particular to an essentially economics-oriented or more broadly, we might call a materialist-oriented view of human well-being.
Right.
That human well-being is fundamentally about things going well in a material way, economically and otherwise, for us in this life, and that the gospel is really about a kind of revolutionary struggle to right economic injustices and other social injustices in this life, rather than being fundamentally about salvation from sin and purifying our souls for communion in God, with God in the next life. In the 80s, the influences behind liberation theology were essentially Marxist in nature, and it was a kind of an attempt mm-hmm. to marry Christianity to Marxism, and it was very heavily criticized by Pope St. John Paul II and Cardinal Ratzinger in those days, and I quote some important passages reflecting that in the book. In recent years, the basic idea has been picked up by some critical race theorists, and Ibram Kendi is someone who's explicitly identified himself with the liberation theology approach, which he contrasts with what he calls savior theology. And he says, well, savior theology is basically the idea that Christianity is about saving people from their sins, understood as bad behavior, helping them to overcome their sins, reform their souls, and so forth. And that he writes off as basically just a tool of the racist power structure. A genuine Christian theology, in Kendi's view, would be liberation theology, which is about socio-political revolution and overthrowing the forces of white supremacy and capitalism and sexism and homophobia and all that stuff. And Jesus, therefore, is to be seen as a kind of revolutionary in a political sense. He's basically just taking the 1980s style liberation theology, rereading it in racial terms rather than purely economic terms, and presenting it as if it's the only approach to theology that is acceptable from what he thinks of as an anti-racist point of view. This is one of many examples, some of which I've already mentioned, where it's manifest. It's not something like, well, gee, who knows? Can you really reconcile these things? It's manifest that we're dealing with ideas here that are flatly contradictory with what the Catholic Church teaches about these things, with Catholic social doctrine in particular. What Kendi says is the only acceptable theology, liberation theology, as I just summarized his view of it, is exactly the sort of thing that the Church explicitly condemned under Pope John Paul II and Cardinal Ratzinger in the 1980s, and is also condemned, of course, in the longer tradition going back to the 19th century and earlier popes who spoke on matters of social justice and firmly denounced socialism and communism as being false solutions to these problems. Why are people drawn to this stuff? Because people who defend it, they use nice sounding phrases like anti-racist. Who could object to being anti-racist? Racism's evil. So of course we should be against it. We should be anti-racist. But that doesn't mean that everything somebody peddles under that label is acceptable. What happens is when people use nice language like that, and they're also extremely aggressive and condemn anyone who disagrees as racist, as bigoted, and so forth. And when the cultural forces that represent this point of view have the wind at their backs, as it were, then it's easy for people, for Christians and Catholics in particular, to think, well, maybe I should get behind this, you know? And in fact, since the general culture is so hostile overall to Christianity and Catholicism in particular, maybe this is one area where we can have something in common and we can have some kind of victory, because at least we can agree that racism is bad. So yeah, I'll jump on this bandwagon and then I won't seem to be such a bad guy because I'm associated with this allegedly reactionary and troglodyte institution and so forth. So the temptation could be overwhelming to jump on this critical race theory bandwagon and pretend that somehow it's just an application of Catholic social doctrine. It's totally the reverse of that. It's a delusion to think otherwise, and it's a very dangerous delusion because the ideas are, as I say, directly opposite to the principles of Catholic social teaching that the popes have consistently hammered out really for centuries now.
You know, one thing I've noticed is that Catholics who are pushing, you know, sort of full-on critical race theory, very often they sort of they will begin by presenting themselves as, you know, orthodox Catholics. Not always. Sometimes they don't bother to sort of to claim that, but in some cases they do. But after a while, you do see them sort of selling out church teaching in other areas, whether it's putting their pronouns in their bio or whatever. You see them embracing other aspects of the, because it's all interconnected with, you know, gender ideology and things like that. It seems to very quickly become a way, an excuse to sort of like vent your resentment against the church, or just against sort of other Catholics, against other Orthodox Catholics, whatever. So often, I mean, there's some people who really do care about racial issues, whether, you know, in a good way or just in a misguided way. But there also seems to be people who use the racism issue as kind of, I don't know if stalking horse is the right word. Maybe a Trojan horse would be the better word to sort of attack the church more generally, because you can always claim the church is insensitive to racial minorities or whatever. That's not a heretical claim. It's a factual claim, you know, about church leadership at any given time, right? It could be right or wrong, but it seems to be a way often to ignore other issues to make this the most important issue, so that, you know, issues of whatever it is, whether it's sexual morality or something else, can be ignored, or to simply sort of discredit church authority, or just an excuse for pride to sort of have a reason to have contempt for your fellow Catholics. And I'm not putting forth any kind of grand theory of people's motivations here, but I've just seen all of these things at play in different examples of people who are really getting deep into this ideology in the church, you know, mainly from observation on social media. I don't know what your thoughts are about
that. I think it's a mix. So I do think there are people that fit the description you've just given. There are people who, because the church definitely teaches social justice, teaches against racism and so forth. They think, okay, well, critical race theory is about being opposed to racism. It's about social justice. Therefore, as a Catholic, I can and maybe even should embrace those things. Well, okay, yeah, that's true. But the thing is that, you know, the phrases social justice and the phrases anti-racism are not magical. I mean, people attach different meanings to them. So calling something anti-racist or social justice doesn't magically transform it into something compatible with Catholicism. I think some people are well aware of that, and they just don't care. What they really are committed to is not what the church has always understood social justice to be, or what the church has had in mind in condemning racism. What they really have in mind is a kind of secular agenda that is justified by premises that have nothing essentially to do with Catholicism, and they're not really even interested in Catholic orthodoxy, but it's a kind of useful way to try to sell it, is to try to sell it as somehow Catholic. And that kind of, you know, and so that's the kind of cynical approach that is represented by people who, you know, already independently, even before critical race theory became a big thing, were known for their rejection of longstanding Christian Catholic teaching in matters of sexual morality and so forth.
Right.
And no surprise there, it's the usual suspects. Of course, this is just the latest, you know, progressive bandwagon they're going to jump on, no surprise there. So there are some people like that. But I think there are also people who are not like that. They're not really heterodox. They don't reject any moral or other teaching of the church, and they don't want to, but nevertheless are intimidated by the fact that Catholic teaching on matters of sexual morality, for example, is now more than ever something that makes you a pariah if you accept it, if you preach it. Now more than ever puts you on the cultural margins. And so for some of these people, it's kind of, talk of anti-racism and critical race theory rolls along, it's a kind of useful way to stop talking about all this unpopular stuff. And instead talk about something that's more popular and makes you sound like part of the club. Oh, yeah, you're just one of the guys now. And you can say, well, I'm not talking about those other things because here's one move people make. Well, I'm not talking about those other things because the people who do talk about them are all these mean, nasty, racist people. And it's really those mean, nasty, racist people who've turned people off of the church's teaching on sexual morality. So maybe we need to stop talking about that stuff so much instead talk about racism and adopt the critical race theory program and so forth. And then they can seem to be good Catholics. They don't have to reject any Catholic doctrine. They found an excuse not to talk about it anymore. And they don't have to be associated with these people that are culturally on the margins, and they can be part of the club and signal their virtue at the same time. Wow, what a deal that is, right? So now I'm painting a very negative psychological portrait here. And I think with some of these people, they deserve it. With others of them, maybe they don't deserve that. Some of them are well-meaning but very naive. I think it is very naive and really delusional to think that this stuff is all innocent and can be reconciled with Catholic teaching. But I do think there's a spectrum. So you have people who are well-meaning but naive. You have people who are not so naive, but they're more cowardly, and they're not heterodox, but they would rather just avoid talking about the controversial doctrines so they can look like the nice guy and look like they're up to date and in line with mainstream thinking. And then on the other extreme, there are more cynical people who don't care about Catholic teaching anyway. And this is just kind of the latest stalking horse by which they can promote a kind of heterodoxy within Catholicism.
I have noticed with members of my own generation that some people are, they want to be Orthodox, but they're also very they're very uncomfortable, as you indicated, with being out of, you know, being so culturally marginal that they do want to be Orthodox on everything that is, you know, absolutely clear cut. You have to believe this to be Catholic, but they will seek as much wiggle room, you know, as possible in other areas. In other words, whenever they rather than seeking a Catholic spirit in the way they think about everything, whether it's sort of dogmatically defined or not, they will be very eager to adopt a worldly position on everything that they can, to decrease that discomfort of being out of step. And I can kind of understand that to a certain extent. And sometimes it does get a little bit scary, not in terms of sort of human respect solely, but just like it can be a little disorienting to think so differently from other people around you, right? I do think that there's also a human respect aspect to it, and it could be. I'm not just talking about racial things, although that's one place where it can seem like very plausible in terms of this is Catholic being anti-racist, right? You know, like you were saying, but also with feminism or even things like science, like how you interpret Genesis. Some people are like, as long as I can do a non-literal reading of this, this aspect of creation, I will. And I'm not even saying people have to believe, Genesis totally literally in every respect, obviously. But it's just something that I noticed, that people are eager to defer to the sort of like worldly wisdom as much as they can without being in the red in terms of church teaching. It's just I don't know that I have a point. It's just a phenomenon that I've noticed. It's not everybody, like you're saying. Everybody's different.
I think that's true. Yeah, I think that's true of some people. And one of the ironies here is that they often thereby end up politicizing the faith, whereas at the same time they accuse other people of doing the same thing, and sometimes rightly. So part of what goes on here is that people who are drawn to Catholics in particular, who are drawn to critical race theory and the anti-racist movement and so forth, they often accuse the critics of critical race theory of being politically motivated and of somehow just falling in with some sort of right-wing political agenda.
Right.
Now, that's ridiculous. If you look at the arguments in my book, there's nothing in there that requires acceptance of any Republican Party or conservative or right of center political program. That's all just propaganda when people say right. that sort of thing. But there certainly are Catholics who are too closely identify Catholicism with whatever, the current political interests of the Republican Party are. Yes, there are people who do that, of course, and they shouldn't do that. Not everybody who's right of center does that. And too many people who are too quick to fling that accusation at everybody they disagree with. But yeah, there are people who do that. But at the same time, many people who fling this accusation at the same time, they're really doing the same thing on the left. They're just adopting what happens to be the flavor of the month on the progressive side of the political spectrum. And they've decided that, well, if people who are criticizing critical race theory tend to be right wingers, though they're actually not all right wingers as it happens. But if they tend to be right wingers, and if people on the left tend to be more favorable to critical race theory, well, I'll go with critical race theory then. Well, how is that any less politicized than people who identify their faith with, Republican Party politics?
Right.
There's politicization on both sides, and it should be avoided. Any Catholic should first and foremost want to know, what does the faith actually teach? And I would judge any political program or party or proposal in light of that, rather than the other way around. That's a very solid principle. And when people on the left, when Catholics, on the left say that Catholics on the right should not be doing that, should not be putting, identifying their politics with their religion, I totally agree with that. But the same thing holds on the left as well. And I think that's exactly what's going on with people who, at least many people, who are keen to jump on board the critical race theory bandwagon. It's really their politics that's in the driver's seat, and it's not theology and it's not the Catholic faith.
All right, Ed, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. I really appreciate your being generous with your time. Again, the book, People Is All One in Christ, A Catholic Critique of Racism and Critical Race Theory, from Ignatius Press. I will link to that, and I'll also link to some of the other things on Ed's blog that we talked about earlier in the discussion. Everybody, thank you for listening. If you're watching on YouTube, please subscribe. And Ed, thank you very much.
Great to be here. Thanks a lot. Thank you.